It's a long way to Tipperary. It's a long way to go. It's a long way to Tipperary, to the sweetest girl I know. Goodbye, Piccadilly.
I never quite trust microphones, so can everybody hear me at the back? Thank you. Before we go on our journey through London's entertainment delights, I just wanted to talk a little bit about my day job, because I think that puts into context what I'm going to talk about today. As Steve said, I work at Mary Evans Picture Library, and for those of you who haven't heard of us, we are the UK's leading source for historical images. And actually, the library was formed in 1964, so we're celebrating our own anniversary this year, and we're 50 years old. I'm not, but the library is. Now, we have, for the past five decades, been providing publishers, magazines, newspapers, TV companies, greetings card companies, museums, and so on, with images from all periods of history on all genres and themes. Now, the library was built up by Mary and her husband, Hilary, over the years, and we're based in Blackheath in a converted parish hall, which all sounds very charming and probably is, actually. We represent over 300 different contributors, but what makes us really unique is that in the library we house our own archive of prints, books, illustrated books, posters, music sheets, cigarette cards, postcards, and also we have a fantastic range of periodicals. We also house and manage the Illustrated London News Picture Library, which is a magazine archive which includes the eponymous ILN, but also includes magazines like The Sphere, The Tatler, The Sketch, The Bystander. Now, it's actually these magazines that form the basis of a lot of things I write, talk, and blog about. And they are absolutely fantastic. Most of them are weekly magazines. They are very much talking about what were the preoccupations, things that people were interested in at the time. They're stuffed with photographs, with cartoons, illustrations, front covers. You get a real sense of who's who, what people were worried about, what people were interested in, what was the latest show, what was the latest fashion, that kind of thing. So they give a very kind of immediate sense of what was going on. Now, what we have, certainly the First World War was a real kind of golden period for illustrated magazines. So we have at least 9 or 10 publications in the library which were all published between 1914 and 1918, I mean, either side as well. But for that reason, we are a really great resource for anything on the Great War. And my book, which is coming out at the beginning of June, Great War Britain, draws very much from the Tatler and the Sketch, which were high-quality magazines. They were aimed at a well-heeled readership. But because of that, and because they were sixpence and sevenpence each rather than twopence, they're very good quality. The reproduction on the pages is excellent. They could pay some of the best illustrators and cartoonists and writers. So I've drawn on that for my book, and actually also forms the basis of this talk. I have a chapter on entertainment in the book, and I hope that I will. I know I'm probably going to be talking about a few things today that a lot of you already know about, but I hope I can reveal a few unexpected things as well. So if you were your average Tommy arriving home on leave from the front, you'd probably be rolling into one of the major terminuses in London. Now, if you lived in London, that's probably fine. You'd probably arrive, get off your train, get on a bus, get on a tram, go home. But obviously there were a huge number of soldiers who arrived in London and didn't know where to go. They'd never been in the capital before. And to top it all, it was usually very dark, certainly from May 1915, when Zeppelin raids and air raids began over London. Blackout was order of the day at night. And so it was usually very, very dark. So soldiers arriving in London were often met by voluntary motorists who would be ready to pick them up and transport them to somewhere to stay in London. Well, they might be lucky and bump into a pretty young lady as well. This is sort of a typical cartoon. But they would often be taken to a YMCA hut, and there were a great number of these around London, dotted around central London, temporary huts that were set up. And they provided accommodation, food, company, companionship, and also entertainment. And you can see here, I can't remember which hut this is. It's not the Shakespeare hut, but it's one of the huts. And as you can see, there's a sort of impromptu little concert going on. There's somebody at the piano there. They might be singing Tipperary, they might be singing When Irish Eyes Are Smiling, they might be singing Keep the Home Fires Burning. But this was the kind of thing that an ordinary soldier coming to London might expect if he ended up in a YMCA hut. He'd also have to probably sleep on the floor because there were minimum beds, and they'd have to lie down wherever they could find space. This is an illustration by Fortunino Matania, who was a staff artist on the Sphere magazine. And this is the Shakespeare Hut, actually, and this is showing Christmas entertainment in the Shakespeare Hut with a huge tree, which I'm surprised to see, actually, because Christmas trees did go a little bit out of favour, considering their Germanic origins. But you can see there's a gramophone, and there are presents being given out. They might also go to the Union Jack Club at Waterloo, which I'm sure you're all familiar with. This is an advert which I found in one of our magazines, and it shows the smoking room at the top with men playing board games and obviously smoking a lot. What's quite interesting is the Tatler magazine, within weeks of the war's outbreak, started a campaign. All the magazines did something to do with fundraising, or and what they did was they launched the Tatler Games Bureau, and they asked their readers to buy board games, chess sets, playing cards in order to provide amusements for soldiers home on leave at places like this, and certainly for convalescent wounded soldiers in hospital who otherwise would have nothing to do. So that was the Tatler's thing. They asked people to buy games from shops like Gamages and Holborn. This is the entrance of the Union Jack Club, again drawn by Matania, showing soldiers from all kinds of regiments arriving, and far off in the distance you can see one of the rooms with people already settling down. Now, these sort of clubs and huts provided general comfort. They provided somewhere to lay your head, and they would provide an element of amusement, but these men were in London, and I'm sure that the lure of the capital soon brought them out and roaming the streets, finding something to do. I wanted to put this picture in because I think this is lovely. This is a scene witnessed. It's by an artist called Amato in the graphic, and it's a scene where some British Tommies meet some French soldiers on the London Underground, which I thought was rather nice. But it could very well have happened if they were exploring the capital. Now, there was a bit of a kind of dilemma when war broke out about what people should do. Should they seek amusement? Should they, enjoy entertainment? People were worried about enjoying themselves. And this cartoon's by Douglas McKenzie in a magazine called The Sketch. And it's actually entitled Educating the Masses, War Economy. And as you can see, this is London not worrying too much at all about the fact that theatre is thriving and there's lots and lots to do. And actually, in the end, there were several reasons to keep the theatre going in particular. One was that soldiers arriving in the capital did need amusement. They needed their spirits raising. it also provided employment for people.
In fact, the sketch in 1915 wrote that such abstention was the cause of much hardship and unemployment in theatre land, and that a visit to the theatre was an excellent moral tonic and gave relief to strained nerves. There was always a lot of talk about strained nerves and how to relieve them, and the theatre was the ideal way to do this. Now, the other thing that the theatre could obviously do was boost morale, but also it was a perfect place to recruit people. So this cartoon, which is by Norman Morrow, who was the Bystanders theatrical artist, it's talking about the fact that war plays were fine, but soldiers home on leave didn't want to see anything depressing. And that pretty much characterises the theatre in the Great War. It was vibrant, new shows proliferated, but there was nothing serious. There were no great plays written during the Great War period. What people's tastes were for light-hearted reviews, pretty girls, beautiful costumes. Things were war-themed, but what they wanted was humour, things they could relate to, but without getting depressed about. This is from the Bystander magazine, Enough of War Plays. So you can see that we don't want pictures of people being stabbed and, you know, Belgians being taken captive by the Germans. They want pretty girls and officers saying, top hole, fantastic. Another characteristic of the theatre in the war was you would see the auditoriums were full of khaki. This is actually a rather lovely illustration by Norman Morrow's brother, Edwin. And that is showing soldiers up in the gods at the opera. Now, you wouldn't expect perhaps to see your average Tommy at the opera, but there we are. This is at Drury Lane in Christmas 1915, and Drury Lane was famous for its pantomimes, and this is wounded soldiers watching, and they're watching Puss in Boots, actually, and there they are puffing away on pipes, and they're being served tea by lady volunteers who are on hand to help them. One of the early shows which proved incredibly popular was Peg of My Heart. And now that starred this lady, Lorette Taylor. And she's pictured here with her co-star, a little terrier dog who happened to be called Michael, which seems like a very incongruous name for a dog, but there you are. Now, Lorette Taylor was American, and Peg of My Heart was written by J. Hartley Manners, who she happened to be married to as well. But Lorette Taylor, you can see she's got that wonderful sort of soft, feminine face, and she was really one of the pin-ups of the day. She in the programme to Peg of My Heart, yes, I've written it down here, she included a little letter to the great British public, and this was inserted in each programme every night. And she conveyed a hope that the day would arrive quickly, when your armies will return victorious and I can shout with you. So that's sort of, that's in 1914. But already there were American actresses who were really showing real sort of support to the British troops. Now, another American actress is Elsie Janis. Elsie, again, was very popular when war broke out. She'd been starring in a review called The Passing Show. And she was, again, a great proponent of that, you know, we must keep the theatre going. She said something like, the men must have music, laughter, and how they laughed. The men must be made to forget it, and they were. So she was known as the sweetheart of the American Expeditionary Force. When America entered the war, she went to the front and she entertained the troops. She did like 5 or 6 shows a day. It was incredible. But back to her role in The Passing Show, these are a few scenes taken from the sketch. And she's shown here with her co-star, Basil Hallam. Now, I wanted to talk about Basil Hallam. They were actually engaged to be married, although this page from the Tatler, I think, talks about the fact that they have denied their engagement. I don't think they really wanted to announce it, and it came out. Now, Basil's role in The Passing Show was very famous. He was known as Gilbert the Filbert, Colonel of the Canuts. Now, a nut or a canut was a typical dandyish gentleman's swell, and very much the antithesis of the dutiful serving soldier. Basil played it wonderfully. He'd actually, when he'd first trodden the boards, he'd been very keen to be a Shakespearean actor, a serious actor. But his role in The Passing Show, it earned him a legion of adoring female fans. He was incredibly popular. And there's him and Elsie looking very charming together. Lady Diana Manners, who went on to become Lady Diana Cooper, she recalls of Basil in her memoirs, you know, how I could have danced all night with Basil Hallam. So I think he's very much forgotten now, but he was a real, you know, a real sort of star at the time. However, he was also a young man, very much in the spotlight. He'd suffered with problems with his knees. He had metal plates in his hips and his ankles. And because of that, he certainly couldn't have served in the infantry. And many people told him there's absolutely no need for you to join up. You're doing your bit on the stage. However, he couldn't carry on. He was very much in the spotlight, and he felt the fact that friends and acquaintances were going off to the front and very keenly. And he joined the kite balloon section. He became a balloonatic because I suppose he didn't have to move terribly much when he was in a basket suspended in the air. He actually said of it that he hated it. Every time he went up there, he had terrible seasickness. But he was also very brave, and in his spare time, he entertained the men. He would go out in the rain and sing a few songs to them. So he's very, very popular. However, one day, his balloon, he was on a mission, and his balloon broke free of its cable, started to drift towards the enemy lines. And him and the guy he was in the basket with had to jump for it. And Basil jumped. His harness slipped, his balloon didn't open, and he fell to his death. And very sadly, that was the end of him. Now, Elsie received a letter from his commanding officer, who said every bone in his body was broken, but his face was still intact, and he looked very peaceful. I think that was probably quite a kind thing to say to him. Another person who knew him, Raymond Asquith, the eldest son of the Prime Minister, who himself was going to be killed in a couple of weeks after Basil. Basil wrote to Diana Manners saying, I've got it here somewhere, it's quite terrible actually, killed before my very eyes by falling 6,000 feet or so from an escaped balloon. He came to earth in a village half a mile from where I stood, shockingly foreshortened but recognisable by his cigarette case. Elsie also received a letter from the young man who had been in the basket with Basil and who had survived. His parachute had worked, and he wrote, and he said that Basil had given him real strength. They'd sat on the edge of the basket, and Basil said, right, we're going to count to three and we're going to jump. And this young man wrote to Elsie saying, I never thought that Gilbert the Filbert would fill me with such bravery. So that's the end of poor Basil Hallam, and who knows, he may have been remembered more if he had lived longer. But there were other men of the theatre who also lost their lives. This is Harold Chapin, who was an actor and playwright. He joined the Royal Army Medical Corps and he was killed at the Battle of Loos. And there were a number of others. Back to the theatre and back to what people's tastes were. This is Tommy Atkins, which was a show which had started in the late 19th century. And this was put on very quickly at the Lyceum Theatre in September 1914. I think what always really, amazes me is how quickly people responded and how quickly the war kind of, a war complexion took over the theatre and stage land. And I talked also about the power of the theatre in terms of recruitment. Now, this is a number of people, patriotism in the music halls. So we've got Mr. Jameson Dogs here singing Soldiers of the King at the Coliseum. We've got Mr. Hayden Coffin singing Tommy Atkins, Leslie Stiles singing Stick to Your Guns at the Empire, and Leo Stormont reciting patriotic poetry and prose at the Palladium. This is popular actress Phyllis Dare, the main picture, and the singer Evie Green. And they were singing in aid of the Queen's Work for Women Fund, and they were singing Paul Reumann's very famous song, which I haven't got in here. I thought that was my next slide. But Your King and Country Need You. We've actually got the music sheet at Mary Evans, but sadly I missed it out. Another popular theme were male impersonators. Now, this has been going a long time. You know, there was quite a lot of women who impersonated males in the late Victorian music hall. But this is the French actress Alice Delicia, and she's in khaki. You know, a lot more women did this on the stage, and they would sing recruiting songs. This is Ella Shields, dressed up as a soldier and a midshipman. This is Hetty King, again, another famous male impersonator. And the most famous of all, which I'm sure you've all heard of, Vesta Tilly. Vesta Tilly was actually over 50 years old when she was still doing this act, acting as a young Tommy. And this is her doing a piece called 6 Days Home on Leave. I think it's at the Palladium. And there she is holding her Pickelhauber helmet. Vesta Tilly's memoirs are really interesting, and you know, if you get a chance to read them, I would recommend them. She talks about being involved in an air raid in London, and she was in a room with Lily Langtry. They were resting after a show in the Savoy Mansions, which was sort of attached to the Savoy Hotel, and some bombs were dropped, and literally the two of them were blown across the room. And when they looked through the window, there was an enormous hole. So Lily Langtry and Vesta Tilly Neely didn't make it through the war, but they're very lucky. The other type of play, which was quite popular, which dealt with the war but in a different way, was the German spy play. So anything that talked about, I mean, this certainly fueled the paranoia about German spies in Britain at the time. And this is Isabel Elsom and Dennis Eady in The Man Who Knew Too Much. No, not The Man Who Knew Too Much. It's The Man Who Stayed at Home, sorry. But there were others as well. This is a page from the Sporting Dramatic News showing scenes from it. You see it's very, very dramatic. I think there's a dead pigeon there on the right. Being caught by a German. So, we've talked about spy plays, we've talked about recruiting songs, but actually the most popular shows of the Great War didn't really deal with the war at all. This is Chu Chin Chow. Chu Chin Chow opened at His Majesty's Theatre, I think it was in May 1915. And it was loosely based on Ali Baba and his 40 Thieves. It drew on the kind of the taste for Orientalism, which was already pervading London before the outbreak of war. And it ran for, it was something like, I've got this written down here. Yeah, 2,238 performances. And it was estimated it was seen by 2.8 million people, which I think is absolutely staggering. Now, was it the spectacular stage sets? Was it the cast of live animals, including a camel? It wasn't that. It was actually this. It was the skimpy costumes. And that's what really drew audiences to Chu Chin Chow. And magazines like the Tatler and Sketch, which always like to dabble a little bit in the, you know, dabble in a bit of titillation, would often publish the costumes used in Chu Chin Chow. And every year they would change them a bit just for an excuse to be able to talk about them again. And as you can see, for the time, they were quite revealing, and no wonder every soldier on leave wanted to go and see Chu Chin Chow. This is one of the dancers in Chu Chin Chow, Dacia, who is always very exotic looking. And this is Miss Lily Brayton. Now, she was married to Oscar Asche, who produced and starred in Chu Chin Chow. But there she is endorsing Doresca cigarettes. And you know you've made it, you know, a show has made it, if you are pictured in your show's costume promoting a cigarette brand. And it just goes to show how significant it was. The other show, I'm going to talk about three big shows. Chu Chin Chow is one. The Bing Boys Are Here is another one. There's Alfred Lester, Violet Lorraine and George Robey on the front cover of the Tatler. And this was just, you know, an incredibly popular show. It was written by George Grossmith, Fred Thompson, and it was described as a picture of London life and a prologue in six panels. And it featured the popular song, If You Were the Only Girl in the World and I Was the Only Boy. Now, George Robey was best known as a music hall artist. He was known as the Prime Minister of Mirth. And he'd had already had a very long and successful career. But he was used to maybe doing two sketches a night, sort of perhaps in two different reviews. And his wartime schedule really, really ramped up his activity. It was incredible. He starred in The Bing Boys Are Here, which, of course, he did every night. When war first broke out, he joined the Special Constabulary. I'm not actually quite sure when he slept, because he would do his show, and then he would be a special constable from 2 a.m. till 6 a.m. So presumably at some point in the day, he would have a bit of a sleep. And he then joined the Volunteer Motor Transport Corps, who were the sort of people who would be picking up the soldiers as they arrived in London. And he does describe in his memoirs about a number of men being quite surprised when he turned around to see that George Robey was their taxi driver. There he is. I think he looks a bit creepy there, but never mind. It was very popular. Yes, his character Lucifer Bing. Now, George Robey, the phrase "work tirelessly for charity" is often overused, but I think with George Robey, it's absolutely justified. He supported countless charities. He put on loads and loads of charity reviews and performances. This is him entertaining wounded soldiers here. I mean, he did this sort of thing almost every day. And he also, when he started fundraising shows, he had to put them on a Sunday. The first one he did was for the buffet at Waterloo Station. When soldiers arrived in London, there would be a voluntary buffet which provided them with tea, sandwiches and a bit of cake to keep them going. And because this was run entirely on sort of a charitable basis, they were running out of funds. George Robey decided, right, I'm going to have to do something. And he decided to help the Waterloo buffet. And he spoke to Sir Oswald Stoll, who said he could use the Coliseum on a Sunday. And he put on a show and it raised absolutely loads. But not everybody was terribly happy about this. And he did receive some letters. Sir, in answer to a request to take tickets for a concert to be held on a Sunday for good old Bart's Hospital, I write to say that I and a good many of my friends most entirely disapprove of Sunday being desecrated in this way and must decline our support. I feel sure the hospital may lose and not gain by such trifling with the day God has called holy. Now, that might as well have been signed Disgusted of Tunbridge Wells. But George Robey, of course, had the right response. My dear madam, there is an old adage, the better the day, the better the deed. As I have two performances every day of the week, it is impossible for me to give my time to a matinee show except on a Sunday. It is also impossible on a weekday to get the Coliseum, which is the only house in which a really good sum of money can be realised. The cause is good. We held the concert at an hour when it does not interfere with divine service, and I am glad to say I managed to get £4,500 for the grand old British institution whose interests I have so much at heart. Here he is again, and he's in Trafalgar Square here, giving a recruiting speech. And interestingly, the other guy in this picture is Horatio Bottomley, who was editor of John Bull magazine. And George Robey eventually, in 1954, was given a knighthood. Horatio Bottomley was sent to prison for embezzling his readers' funds. He encouraged them to invest in war bonds and embezzled the money himself. So there's a bit of a contrast there. Here's George Robey again, the bottom right picture. He's in October 1918. A massive event was held in London called Our Day, with stalls and shops and Trafalgar Square, everyone sort of fundraising and doing bits and bobs. And here's George Robey auctioning a pig, which I think was given by the Wandsworth Allotment Association or something. But he did an awful lot of good work in hospitals as well. And he, if anybody's read Pat Barker's book, Toby's Room, which talks about the men at the Queen's Hospital in Sidcup who had the disfiguring facial injuries. He visited that hospital quite a lot. And the reason his interest in this started was a number of them had come to see one of his shows and they were in a box in the theatre. And the most badly maimed men were actually put to the back so that people didn't see them. And I think he was performing in a show called Joy Bells at the time. And Roby didn't feel this was fair, that these men had to hide away. And there was one man whose entire jaw was taken away. And Roby called him Merry Eyes because his eyes were still there and he felt... and it, apparently it really boosted the man's morale. And that's what he was ever after known as in hospital. He also recounts a time when a man who had shell shock hadn't spoken, hadn't laughed since he'd come to hospital, watching one of George Robey's shows, he laughed out loud and began his sort of path to recovery. Now, this is a cartoon by the great artist H.M. Bateman in The Tatler, and it's showing George Robey with money falling through the sky into his characteristic bowler hat, and that just reflects how much money Roby raised for charity during the war. I can't remember whether it's 50,000, I think it was £500,000, which in today's money is millions. So he was an extraordinary man. Another lady, George Roby wasn't a lady, although he did sometimes dress up as a lady, but another theatre star who took a great interest in charities was the French actress Gabi Delise, the one and only Gabi, as she was known. And Gabi was absolutely delectable. She wasn't a great singer, she wasn't a fantastic dancer, but she had it, she had charisma. And the thing that Gabi did was she dressed up to the nines on stage, and she was known for her very extravagant, lavish headdresses. And, you know, going to see these wonderful, lavish costumes in the theatre was another form of escapism for people. People had to be very careful about clothing and what they wore, not to appear extravagant. They couldn't afford new clothes anyway. But on the stage, you could, you know, escape into this wonderful world of fantasy fashion, and Gabi obliged audiences in that respect. Here she is, caricatured on the front cover of the sketch in one of her headdresses again. And this is a cartoon by Alec P.F. Ritchie showing an officer decorating his dugout with pictures of her. This is her entertaining wounded soldiers at a home in Kensington Gore. So there they are playing the fool and somebody pretending to be a German soldier and Gabby's stabbing him or something. And here she is giving an officer a ride in a motorbike and sidecar. There's a story about her. She was at a garden party. She was dressed in one of her wonderful outfits. And there were a number of wounded soldiers there. And she went towards one of them and he held out his arms. And of course, his hands were missing. And that was what sort of, you know, made her decide that she was going to concentrate her efforts on charity. Another actress, this is Lily Elsie, beautiful Lily Elsie, who was best known for her role in The Merry Widow in Edwardian times. And again, she did an awful lot for charity. Her particular interest was St. Dunstan's hostel for blinded sailors and soldiers. And these two pictures, which I found, show her spending time with these men. She's been taken for a row by two there, and she's lighting the cigarette of another. Gladys Cooper, on the left there, looking very dreamy, another very beautiful actress. She's probably a bit more of a thespian than the other ones I've mentioned. She joined a concert party that went to the front in January 1915. It was organised by Seymour Hicks, who is the very debonair guy at the bottom there. And there were a group of about 20 or so artists went over, did a lot of concerts. Gladys was actually about 3 months pregnant with her second child, and she didn't mention it to anybody, so she knew she wouldn't be allowed to go if she said something. And funny enough, she talks about the fact that for a few days, the whole concert party got flu or something. You know, nobody could act. It was only her and another actress who were left standing. When I said I was going to do this talk, somebody asked, are you going to talk about Leslie Henson? So I had to put a picture of Leslie Henson in. Leslie, again, did an awful lot of work with charities, fundraising, organising reviews for war charities. Here he is in Yes, Uncle. And he was also, like Roby, he also worked during the Second World War. In the late 30s, he set up ENSA, which was the Entertainment National Service Association. And but soldiers in the Second World War knew it as every night something awful. Oh, this is Sir Alfred Butt, another guy. He was one of the numerous theatrical impresarios who put on lots and lots of fundraising theatrical events. He also actually joined the Ministry of Food and was instrumental in introducing rationing and food control in 1917. So it wasn't just individuals, it was actually theatres that did stuff as well. And this is the Little Theatre, which was in Haymarket, and that converted itself into a soldiers' clubhouse, again, somewhere to stay and just get some comforts and some entertainment. You can see there's a billiard room there. I know that Lena Ashwell spent time at the Little Theatre, sewing comforts for soldiers, that kind of thing. There's a post office there, and you can see that the stage is being used there as, entertaining soldiers. This picture I absolutely love. These are the ladies of the London Hippodrome, and they set up the Home for Soldiers' Pets. So many soldiers that joined up had pets that they had to leave behind at home. So the actresses at the Hippodrome decided to adopt these orphans. And here they are pictured with what is a rather lovely but quite motley selection of mongrels. But there's some lovely dogs there. Violet Lorraine, who's in the Bing Boys, is there at the front on the left, actually. Another aspect of theatrical entertainment were these what were known as charity matinees. Now, this is a Danish ballerina putting on a show which looks rather dull, if you ask me. But all the pupils were either children or sisters of serving soldiers. And again, it raised money for war charities. But society ladies, who were obviously often featured in the Tatler, also liked to dip their toe in the waters of the theatre, and they put on an awful lot of charity matinees. Now, how interesting these were to actually go and watch, I'm not terribly sure. I fancy that the people playing in them had more fun than the people actually watching them. But this is the angel tableau. I mean, they would literally just pose in very intricate, very prescriptive costume. This is Hazel, Lady Lavery, who was the wife of Sir John Lavery, as a rather terrifying angel. And here's some more. There we are. They're sort of posed as Renaissance paintings. The lady with the sort of bow and arrow there is Mrs. Harold Nicholson, who was Vita Sackville West. So there they are in a scene from the... it's from Mazarine's Omar Khayyam. And it was held at Mrs. Marsh's house in Arlington Street in aid of wartime charities in June 1916. Now, George Roby obviously had to have a little bit of poke a little bit of fun at this sort of thing. And here he is posing with a with an urn, looking very earnest. the title there, it says Shurup. And this was one of his catchphrases in a show that he did. And he recalls an air raid going on during one of his shows and the audience getting a little bit nervous and starting to get up and go. And he apparently just poked his head out of the wings and he went, "Shut up." And everybody laughed and sat back down and they watched the show through the air raid. So society ladies also like to dabble in film. And here we see, this is really interesting. I was fascinating to find this. This is a film called The Great Love, which is a patriotic war film. And Lillian Gish actually played the lead. But a load of society ladies took part in it, showing how the upper classes played their part in the war. It featured Lady Diana Manners, it featured Elizabeth Asquith, daughter of Herbert Asquith. The lady bottom right is Kathleen Pelham Byrne, Lady Droider, who I'll speak more of later. But this film is actually presumed lost now, so there is no other evidence of it. And certainly in the course of writing my book, because I talk so much about high society, this was a really fascinating little snippet. So cinema was another source of entertainment, and cinema was really, you know, going through a boom period during the war. But it was a little bit like the theatre on Sunday. There were certain sections of society who didn't entirely approve. It meant that people could go somewhere in the dark on their own, and all sorts of things could go on in the back seats. This cartoon is by Annie Fish. Annie Fish illustrated the Letters of Eve, which was the gossip column in the Tatler magazine. She did that every week throughout the war. And the little lady dressed up on the right is the eponymous Eve. And there she is with Reggie, who's her sweetheart. And Eve kind of very much talks about what people were doing at the time, what was the fashionable thing to do. So there's an usherette saying, "This way, please." And Eve saying, "Oh, it's very dark." Eve and the reckless one arrive at the pictures and are swallowed up into an impenetrable and sympathetic darkness. I don't think we need to know any more. This cinema auditorium is from the Vickers factory in Barrow and Furness. So, munitions factories even offered cinemas for their workers. And this isn't obviously London-based, this is an American field hospital in France, but men who were unable to sit up and enjoy a film, they projected it onto the ceiling so they could lie in their beds and watch it, and there they are watching a Charlie Chaplin film. As well as the popular films starring people like Charlie Chaplin, there were also the informative films. There was the Battle of the Somme film, which apparently, when it came out in August 1916, around 2 million people saw that film altogether. And this picture was published in the Graphic, and is showing tanks in battle at the Scala Theatre. Guy de Maurier, who was the brother of Gerald de Maurier, wrote a play called An Englishman's Home a few years before the war, which was a very prescient view of what might happen if England was invaded. And this film, I think this film came out about September, October 1914, so very, very early on. They obviously, brought it out really quickly. And, they had terrible Germans doing despicable things to people. Guy de Maurier actually was killed himself in the war, which seems very, very ironic and sad. Now, I said we were going to talk about three plays, and of course, I can't talk about entertainment during the First World War without talking about The Better Owl and about Bruce Bairnsfather. This 1918 film is based on The Better Owl, which was based on a stage play, which was based on the famous cartoon, which appeared in The Bystander in November 1915 and was drawn by Captain Bruce Bairnsfather of the Royal Warwickshire Regiment. Now, we have the complete run of The Bystander at Mary Evans as part of the Island Archive, so we feel very much that it is Bairnsfather's spiritual home. And actually, I've just sent off an introduction and compilation of pictures, because we are doing a book with the History Press about Bairnsfather, which should be out, I think, October, November this year. Anyway, Bairnsfather's cartoons were, it's difficult to actually put into words how popular they were. He was first published in The Bystander, March the 31st, 1915, with a cartoon called Where Did That One Go? And then by the middle of that year, he was producing weekly cartoons, and he continued to do for the rest of the war. He spent time with the French, with the Americans, with the Italians. They all wanted a little bit of that Bairnsfather magic. He depicted the typical British Tommy in the trench. He characterised their stoicism, their wisecracks, and because he was a serving soldier himself, he could identify with them, and people really loved the fact he was a soldier artist. His cartoons in The Bystander were produced as limited edition prints, as playing cards, as jigsaws, as Bairnsfather wear pottery. But also, Bairnsfather himself was a great fan of the theatre, and he really fancied trying his hand as a playwright. And he he wrote a sketch which first appeared in a review called Flying Colours at the Hippodrome. And it was called Bairns Fatherland, and it featured the central character of his cartoons, Old Bill, the curmudgeonly old soldier. And there he is. That's John Humphreys playing him there in Flying Colours. And this is Norman Morrow drawing the scene in The Bystander. And then eventually, in August 1917, a complete play, The Better Owl, opened at the Oxford Theatre in London. And the lead role was played by Arthur Puget, and here he is with his walrus moustache, looking very uncomfortable actually, but looking very authentic, very brilliant, with knitted balaclava. Another publicity shot. And there's the cast. There he is with Bert and Alf. And again, as I said, if you find that your character is endorsing cigarettes, you know you've made it. So there he is. Everybody knows. Well, if you know of a better cigarette, then smoke it, which of course is an homage to if you know of a better old, go to it. But that needed no explanation. Everybody in Britain, everybody fighting at the front would know that joke. Now, this brings me on to another aspect of entertainment in the war, and that was sort of, you know, art, cartoons, and exhibitions. And Bairns Father, such was his popularity, that the Bystander in May 1916 held an exhibition of his work at the Graphic Galleries. The Graphic newspaper was the parent magazine of the Bystander, and they had their own gallery in the Strand. And so people could go and look at the original Fragments from France drawn by Bairns Father. They could also buy them as well. And just this week, actually, an original Bairns Father has sold at Sheffin's Auctioneers for £2,300. So if anybody did buy an original there, they would have made a very canny profit, I think. I love this picture, and I did a book a few years ago called Brushes and Bayonets about cartoons during the First World War. And this picture, sadly, is unattributed, but it's a view from inside the Graphic Galleries, and it's showing a crowd gathering outside and laughing at Bairns Father's pictures inside. I think it's absolutely wonderful. There were lots and lots of other exhibitions as well, and the advantage to exhibitions was you could go in the day when it wasn't dark, and you know, you could probably take the children to a lot of them. Now, this is an exhibition of war photographs, and I can't remember what year this opened. It might be 1917, but it opened at the Grosvenor Galleries, and then it moved to the People's Palace in Mile End, and it showed absolutely enormous photographs taken at the front, and I think really brought the war home to people. There were lots of other exhibitions as well. You know, war artists like Paul Nash, he had an exhibition at the Goupil Galleries. There was the Artist Rifles did an exhibition. There was one at least every week. And then, you know, society painters would paint, you know, famous women of the time, as well as you know, aristocratic soldiers, people like Ambrose McAvoy. Now, this lady who I mentioned earlier is Lady Droyder. And as you can see here, she is the organiser of a successful aircraft exhibition. Lady Droyder was a real dynamo, actually. She was a very keen aviator, and there are lots of pictures of her doing all sorts. She was always in charity matinees. I found a picture of her ploughing a field in a, you know, a nice sort of smock. She did all sorts. I think this picture with the children, I don't think she spent much time with them. But she organised almost single-handedly this incredible aviation exhibition at... Now, this might have been the Grosvenor Galleries as well, actually. Yes, it was the Grosvenor Galleries, but it then travelled. It travelled to Ireland and America. The aim was to raise funds for war charities. Also, you know, it had that kind of recruitment element as well. And it featured lots and lots of artwork and lots of objects, including a German Fokker airplane. And as you can see, it looks like the Imperial War Museum does, or perhaps here. Now, less educational, or at least not education that way, was Raphael Kirchner. And he had an exhibition at the Bruton Galleries in 1915. Now, the Sketch magazine, again, another magazine in our archive, had the exclusive right to publish Kirchner's illustrations in Britain. They'd been originally published in La Vie Parisienne in France, which was quite a risque publication. The sketch wasn't quite in that league, but it did like to print pictures of pretty girls in not very many clothes. And that's what Kirchner specialised in. And the Kirchner girls were probably, aside from music hall actresses, they were the first pin-ups. This one, a duck's egg, was, you know, very odd, but it was very, very popular. You know, soldiers would write in to say how much they liked that. We found pictures in our magazines showing dugouts decorated with Kirchner's pictures. And as you see, they often are quite erotic. And another very popular artist at the time, and I think the First World War really, he found his métier and found real fame, was William Heath Robinson. Heath Robinson produced pictures for the Sketch and the Illustrated Sporting Dramatic News during the war, and they show, again, a very light-hearted view of war at the front. This is the Germans, they always use dastardly techniques. Here they are firing Tatcho bombs at the British. Now, Tatcho was actually a hair restorer, which, so that, you probably see how that makes sense now. And these are some Germans dressed up as French peasants just to try and get past a very biddable British soldier. You know, they did things like they would peel onions to make the British cry. They would fly magnets over to so the buttons pinged off their trousers and the trousers fell down. And when the Second World War broke out, Heath Robinson no longer felt that the Germans deserved such kind, you know, treatment, actually. And he very much concentrated on cartoons of the home front. But, in the First World War, and again, we're going to be doing a book on this, so look out for that. That should come out January next year. I showed a picture by H.M. Bateman earlier. And this is another one by him. Now, H.M. Bateman was best known as for his Man Who series in The Tatler, which showed kind of social faux pas and blustering colonels, everything. But this is him showing two very famous dancers, Florence and Morris Walton. And this kind of takes me into the next theme of this talk, which is dance. And again, the war sort of saw a real upsurge in dancing and also places to dance. Now, people like Florence and Morris Walton often did exhibition dancing. So there might be afternoon thé dansant, where people like them would do a demonstration dance, and then people could join them and they could perhaps give some lessons. But they would also provide cabaret in the evening at supper clubs as well. Now, two other more famous than Florence and Morris Walton were Irene and Vernon Castle. Now, actually, in I think it was possibly the 40s or 50s, there was a Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers film about these two. They were, Vernon was British, Irene was American, and Irene was a real kind of fashion icon as well as a great dancer. She was always featured in our magazines looking superb. But together, they ran very successful dance schools and clubs in America. And then they came to Britain occasionally, and they would do cabaret stints at places like the Carlton Hotel. Vernon joined the Royal Flying Corps. You can see there he's got a cane. He was actually involved in an accident which put him out of action. And very sadly, he actually, when he became a flying instructor in Canada, and I think he had a mid-air collision, he was killed anyway. So sadly, Irene was widowed. Here she is with Rastus, her pet monkey. The couple were very keen animal enthusiasts and were sort of gathered a menagerie around them. And Irene was always pictured with Rastus. So if you could dance, you were made, really. Balls and dances of the pre-war era were out. The London season would once upon a time have seen the large mansions in Mayfair, stage coming out dancers and huge big decadent balls, and that just really wasn't the done thing anymore during the war. So people made their entertainment at home, and we have adverts for the Decca gramophone in every single issue of the magazines at work, because you could It was portable, you could take it to the front, you could take it round your mate's house, and you could all have a dance around the living room, roll up the rug, and off you go. And here's a rather nice illustration. And, you know, dance teachers did very, very well. In fact, I've got a little, Elsie Janis, who I mentioned earlier, she writes in her memoirs, the word jazz, which was new to the British, became a household necessity. Papers wrote editorial about it, duchesses discussed it, bus girls buzzed about it, and dancing teachers reaped the harvest. This is George Grossmith and Peggy Curtin demonstrating one of the new dance crazes. This is the pigeon walk, but it was also the turkey trot and the grizzly bear and the bunny hug. So, where might you go to dance? And this brings me on to the final subject of London's nightlife, and that is supper clubs or nightclubs. Now, there was a bit of a problem in that, obviously, the Defence of the Realm Act really curbed licensing laws. There was Lloyd George, who believed we were fighting the demon drink. So clubs had to stop serving alcohol at 10 p.m. But they could stay open till 2 a.m. But this picture on the front cover of the Tatler is obviously a very obvious metaphor for Britain's abstinence. But was it abstaining? Well, not necessarily. I think people tend to associate nightclubs with the 1920s, but in fact the boom started in 1911 before the war, and during the war, it's probably at the height, there were about 150 clubs and supper clubs in operation in the West End and Soho. Now, I don't know if there's that many today, actually, so I think that just goes to show how popular they were. This is the 400, which was a really well-known club, and you can see the patrons at the tables. And this is Murray's. Now, Murray's opened in 1913. It was started by a Canadian called Jack May. And Jack May, it was so popular, he had to introduce a system for people on the dance floor. So when a gentleman arrived at the club, he would be given a red ticket or a white ticket. And basically people would alternate. So people with a red ticket would dance one dance, and then they would sit down, and the ones with a white ticket would dance. That was how popular it was. Murray's also opened in May 1915, a riverside club in Maidenhead. Now, Maidenhead was a real destination, and it was known as sort of quite a naughty place to go, actually. Officers would often take girls to Skindle's Hotel. And Murray's had a crystal dance floor. This is Luigi Nantra. Now, he was one of the best-known maitre d's in London. He started off his career at the Ritz, and then during the war, he became restaurant manager at Ciro's. There were already branches of Ciro's in Monte Carlo and in Paris, and they operated as restaurants. But because of the licensing laws, they wanted to be able to stay open late. Ciro's opened up as a club in May 1915, yep, same time as Murray's, and it was instantly very, very popular. Now, within a year, however, it had been closed down. And the reason for that was it was raided. 24 police officers raided the club one night and found everybody within with alcohol still on their table at 11 p.m. at night. There's a very interesting transcript of the trial, the court case, in the Times, and I'm going to quote from some of it because, first of all, the defence is incredibly, hilariously flimsy, and also the police officers who are interviewed were so po-faced. I just have to share this here. So, Chief Inspector Glass was in the witness box and the defence counsel was interviewing him. And he described the scene at Ciro's. And he said, 70 or 80 ladies were dancing to music of rather a crude and riotous character. By crude, he meant that the music was rather rough. The musicians evidently struck the notes on their own accord. Now, this was a band that was paid £100 a week, so they'll have known what they were doing. 10 or 12 young men in the club were under the influence of drink, 6 or 7 of whom were dancing. They were not drunk, but he came to the conclusion that they had been drinking because they were jeering, and he thought their manners while dancing were unseemly. And the defence counsel says to Chief Inspector Glass, perhaps you are not acquainted with the latest forms of dancing. Well, I may not be. You do not know the foxtrot or the bunny hug? I do not. If the same thing had taken place in the bar of a public house, the place would have been deemed a disorderly house. Now, another witness was called, and it was somebody who had been in the club that night, and that was Mr. Louis Cotillon, who was managing director of the Sunbeam Motor Company. Apparently, as the 24 police officers came into the club, a glass from Mr. Cotillon's table was swept onto the floor. Now, he claimed that, well, it was because me and my wife got up to dance. But you can just imagine all these police officers and him sort of suddenly going, ooh, you know. He also said that a glass of champagne found on his table had been bought for an officer who would not drink it as he'd just been inoculated. You'd think somebody else would have drunk it. So the defence was based on the fact that, there were drinks found on the table at 11, but nothing had been served since 9 p.m. Well, I think in a club at the calibre of Ciro's and with somebody like Luigi in charge, that would not have happened. So they were clearly doing it. And anyway, they were onto a loser because, in fact, two plainclothes officers had visited the club two nights before. They'd been served what was called cup in a jug, and it was champagne. So there you are. So poor old Ciro's was closed down. It was, and Luigi and one of the other managers, they would find £100, 25 guineas costs, and a further fine of £25 to the club, and closed down for 12 months. However, when it reopened, it was sort of reborn, actually. It became a YMCA centre. But quite a glamorous, luxurious YMCA centre. So this is a picture of it in 1918, and you can see the waitress with the YMCA ribbon across her. So the final thing I wanted to talk about was sort of dances and balls. And as I said, these really were curtailed during the war. So when the armistice was finally signed, within a couple of weeks, a ball was arranged at the Albert Hall, and it was called the Victory Ball. It was perhaps a little bit premature, but society leapt to get tickets for this event, and it was in aid of the Nation's Fund for Nurses. And you can see from this picture that the highlight of the evening was a bunch of society ladies and actresses led by Lady Diana Manners, dressed as Britannia, there she is at the front, parading into the hall. Everybody dressed up in fantastic outfits. There's Elizabeth Asquith as an Aubrey Beardsley drawing, as you do. And here's a nice spread showing all sorts of very elaborate costumes. There's Irene Castle, the best dressed as always. I mean, absolutely fabulous costume for this. Now, so here we are, society celebrating the end of the war. But for one particular guest at this ball, unfortunately, there was no happy ending. And her name was Billy Carlton, and I mentioned her earlier because she was in the picture of Murray's Riverside Club. Billy, throughout the war, had kind of been rising in profile and was becoming a quite popular artist. She appeared in shows called The Boy, Fair and Warmer, and was quite talented. Here she is in Freedom of the Seas, which was the last thing she appeared in, I think. Now, Billy's best friend was a dress designer called Reggie Laville, and apparently she turned up at the Victory Ball in a transparent black costume designed by Reggie, which set mouths gaping. But Reggie wasn't only her friend and her dress designer, he was also her drug dealer. And this shows a rather dark side to, you know, social life in the Great War. And so Billy made her entrance at the Victory Ball, had a great time. She talked to Irene Castle, she talked to Jack May, all these people were called on later, because the next day in the afternoon she was found dead by her maid in her apartment of a drug overdose. So there we are, brilliant career ended in tragedy. And yes, the inquest involved Jack May, because he was renowned for supplying cocaine. Irene Castle was one of the last people to see her, but in the end it was Reggie who and a Chinese drug dealer who kind of was further down the line who were implicated and were imprisoned. So that's a rather tragic end to my journey through London's entertainment and nightlife. But I think it just goes to show that she's just one of the many tragic stories that the entertainment world endured. So I'm just ending on that, but before I let you go, I'm just going to do some shameless self-promotion. I talked about Mary Evans. If any of you are writers, authors, doing exhibitions or anything online, we are the go-to destination for historical pictures. There's our website address. We also have a print site where you can buy pictures. And we've been really pushing to increase our First World War content. We've got some great collections. We're continuing to add stuff all the time. I mentioned my book, Great War Britain. That is out on the 2nd of June. Exciting. And I think David Cohen has been very helpfully handing out leaflets at the back. And if you haven't got one, get one and put it on your Amazon wish list. And I've also, you might be interested to hear about the next one I've got coming out, which is called Knitting for Tommy, which is about the phenomenon of knitting during the Great War. If anybody wants to contact me, there's my email address, and I'm on Twitter as well. I often tweet pictures of things I find in the archive, a lot of First World War stuff, but I do talk about shoes and puppies and cakes as well, so I'll leave it up to you whether you follow me or not. And that's all. Thank you. Hope you enjoyed the show.
It's a long way to Tipperary. It's a long way to go. It's a long way to Tipperary. To the sweetest girl I know. Goodbye, Piccadilly.